Sam Mondry-Cohen is Senior Fellow at the Wharton School in their Sports Analytics and Business Initiative. He is also a consultant to the Philadelphia Phillies and a former assistant general manager for the Washington Nationals baseball team. Sam, when one watches a baseball game today, the talk is all about exit velocity, spin rate, launch angle. What is happening to the game of baseball?
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. Some of what you're seeing is measurement. You know, one of the things that has changed in the game and that you're hearing on the broadcast is that we're now able to measure all sorts of things that we weren't 20, 30 years ago due to increasing gains in technology. And oftentimes these new measurements, these new shiny objects, there's something, you know, interesting in them, but also people are very eager to share and talk about them.
So when we ask for a definition of sabermetrics or analytics, you know, what would be a household, you know, definition that one could use to say for understanding these terms?
Yeah, I mean, Bill James, who's one of the, you know, fathers of sabermetrics, he kind of put forth the definition of the search for objective truth in baseball. Mm-hmm. There's a couple of key components to that. One, it's seen as a search, discipline, something that's not complete, but an endeavor. You know, and then the other thing which there's questions about is this idea of objective truth, objectivity. Can these data really provide answers that are unquestionable? And so it's a discipline to use data to try to find new knowledge oftentimes about the game.
You know, when you say that, Sam, it sounds as if we're talking more than baseball. We're talking about our entire society today.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're seeing a lot of the same phenomenon that you're seeing all over society. Increased measurement, increased surveillance due to technology that can automatically capture, you know, the velocity. The ball was always being hit at 100 miles an hour, and there were always people that could observe and see, you know, that ball was hard hit or that wasn't. But now this idea to know automatically it was hit 100 or 101, you know, that technological advance was not unique to baseball. You're seeing that all over society, but it plays out in baseball.
Is it StatCast?
Yeah, StatCast is a key component. I take it back a little bit further to the ball tracking. StatCast is a technology from the last couple of years that captures the players and it captures exit velocity of the ball off the bat. But the kind of one of the really important groundbreaking innovations was in 2007 when they started being able to track the exact location of the pitched ball. This was done for the television broadcast, you know, where did it cross the plate, but it unearthed, opened a, you know, huge area of analysis that we've seen continuing forward today. But it really starts with being able to measure the baseball precisely in a way that we hadn't before.
You mentioned, just in your brief remark, you mentioned Bill James. And how important is the Society for American Baseball Research?
Yeah, it's incredibly important. There's really kind of two different groups. You know, the Society for American Baseball Research has been around, I believe, since, you know, the 70s. I myself, you know, am a member, and it's a group of baseball fanatics and historians looking to learn more and research the game, you know, largely the historical side. Bill James is kind of separate and apart, honestly. I mean, he came up around the same period of time writing in the late 70s, but he was self-publishing and writing these analyses and investigating various ideas about baseball and putting them out. And people have conflated the two, and they're both kind of important elements to baseball. But I think of Society for American Baseball Research more about history, and, you know, sabermetrics being more baseball analytics, of which Bill James is one of the founding pioneers.
What are some of the misconceptions people have about analytics?
Yeah, I think one misconception is that it's the whole ball game, you know, that right, it's a new and growing discipline, but it only answers really a small subset of questions, or it moves us forward, you know, a small bit. And, you know, most of the game is the same. It is about, you know, these tremendous athletes performing on the field and performing under pressure, and the ability of analytics to move the needle a tiny bit. can sometimes be ascribed to, you know, being the entire game, but really I would say it's just a small component.
Well, I'm wondering how much this plays in terms of hiring. Say, for example, you and I are looking for a new manager. How much is it, maybe we may not say it, but it may be ageism where, you know, and as an older manager, he's not really up with the new, you know, data used and things of that sort. So we might overlook him for a job.
Yeah, I mean, it's becoming a prerequisite, you know, a requirement that if you aren't well-versed in modern analytics and decision-making and the way that front offices are thinking, then oftentimes you won't be a candidate for the manager's job. But what I would say is it's only kind of one hurdle. You need to be able to make decisions in the kind of the way that the front office, you know, believes in. But there are all these other skills that really don't have much to do with analytics, connecting with people, communicating, motivating, that are, you know, essential for the manager's job. And I think the ideal manager is able to do both. But I think you are sometimes seeing people who are really talented in some areas not get an opportunity because maybe that they don't have that modern decision making that the front office are valuing.
You know, I know you were a bad boy at one time, but I was always curious now when I look at, you know, after someone hits a home run, for example, you see a player in the dugout looking at a, you know, little tablet. So I wonder, have we moved from spitting tobacco to talking about launch angles?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it's talking about launch angles. I think, you know, my experience is even more simple. They just, it's more of the technology, you know, they want to see their home run right away. So they watch it. So it's less about, you know, launch angle and more about, television or screens that are everywhere and you know, immediate feedback. So yeah, it's certainly changed, but I think of that as more about technology.
Well, you know, when you say that, you know, I'm watching the game and all of a sudden, and this is recently, you know, all these arrows in terms of, you know, where the ball went and how hard it was hit and things of that sort. And I felt that this is almost a carryover from like our, you know, our video culture, you know, where we want to see the graphics, you know, we want to see the active scoreboard. And so all of a sudden this becomes a thing, which I feel if we're dealing with launch angles and how hard the ball is hit, then that seems to fit in with the home run derby that we see almost overshadowing the All-Star game.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think there's two different, you know, things there that they are intertwined. I mean, I think some of the graphics you see on television, they don't always land. And some of it is a drive to experiment, innovate, you know, be a leader in this. And so I think broadcasts are very willing to you know, try out some new things for the sake of it being new and that they don't always land. You know, I think the increase in home runs that you see from across the league is an improvement, you know, maybe not improvement in the aesthetics of the game, but in terms of, you know, run creation, in terms of winning games. One of the things I think is that baseball players today are, you know, bigger, stronger, faster than they've ever been. And part of that is, you know, part of the stronger is more and more home runs. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think, you know, the criticism that some of the broadcast seems perverted, I think, you know, is right. I don't think it always lands. And maybe, look, they need to experiment to find, you know, what works. But I think when I think of the increase in home runs across baseball, I think of that as a successful strategy, at least from the perspective of players.
You know, when we talk about players, I was thinking of like a country like Dominican Republic, you know, where you would say, for example, you and I are young players down in the Dominican Republic. How much, for example, is what we're talking about affecting the minor leagues?
Yeah, I think some, you know, I think it is changing the way players train. You know, the example from before, you know, the increased value on home run hitting, you are seeing players, you know, try to hit home runs at a younger age, to pull the ball, hit the ball in the air. I think these things are filtering, you know, filtering down. But there's also kind of a, you know, I think a time and a place for all these things. I think, mm-hmm. you know, I've spent time in the Dominican Republic traveling, and it is incredible to see the baseball culture, see these, you know, 8-10-year-old kids playing catch or playing pickup games. Mm-hmm. And I don't think, you know, the modern data analytics revolution is changing what those games look like. Mm-hmm. Or plays a role in whether those are happening or not. But you know, training for high school and college age baseball player today looks different, and there's certainly different technology attached to what it was 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Let's go. You know, you sort of answered my question. I was going to ask you about, you know, the scouting aspect, how much is this helpful, and also the training. Let's talk about game preparation. You're a starting pitcher, and you're sitting down with the catcher. What are you actually looking at if you're going through the lineup? How does what we've been talking about in terms of data, how's it now helping us where we've got a game tonight?
Yeah, I mean, oftentimes they're describing, you know, baseball phenomenon that we've been talking about for a long time. So for example, you know, batter's tendency on the first pitch, you know, I mean, baseball, you know, coaches and experts have for a long time have talked about this player is going to swing, you know, very often first pitch. Yogi Berra was known as like a bad ball hitter. There may be somebody I coach, this guy never swings at the first pitch. You know, I've seen him watch a number of games, or a scout who's been at 10 games and I watched for 10 games, 40 at bats, he never swung at the first pitch. Now, I mean, we know that automatically. You know, you don't need to have somebody there. We have that in a database. What is your swing rate by count? And so one of the things a pitcher is going to do to prepare for every game is want to know of my opponents, who are these guys that are, you know, swing really often first pitch, and who are those that don't? You know, one thing I'll say is that they're probably not going to internalize that for every count. You know, they're not going to say, oh, here's the guys that swing often 2-2, and here's the, there's too many counts.
Right.
And, you know, one of the nice things about the first pitch is it comes up in every single at bat. You know, how often are you going to get into a 2-2 count is unclear. So, I mean, one of the things that a pitcher wants to know is that. I mean, another thing would be tendencies by pitch type. You know, who can hit the fastball, who can hit the breaking ball. Again, we've known that this is an important feature of describing hitters, you know, for a long time. But now the ability to answer that question automatically, you know, we know every single curveball the guy has thrown because we have this pitch data, and we know what happened to every single curveball. Was it?
Yeah, but Sam, I don't push back on you. I see what you're saying, and I accept that. But then there's this, and maybe this is philosophical. When I think about baseball, I think that there's a human factor that there are errors in baseball. You know, it might be fouls and some other, you know, offsides and stuff, but there are errors in baseball. And there's something very human about that. Something that when we look at what just passed in terms of, say, the World Series, there's always a surprise element. Okay. You're not going to know that someone's going to pitch a no hitter. You're not going to know, for example, somebody that's hitting like 218 is going to be the World Series, you know, hitter with the key hits. And that's what I like about the game, that surprise element, the fact that it's something very human, that when the ball's hit at you and you mess up, you mess up, you know. And what happened? You could be a Golden Glove person and all of a sudden you mess up because you're human. I say that because, you know, we've got 1 year before, it seems like the umpires will be listening to what the robots say. This human factor of the game, how much is that being compromised?
I mean, I think it's still there just, you know, just as much as before. But I mean, if we go back to this example about how much, you know, to your point, is it, am I as a pitcher trying to profile the other hitters? And I say, hey, look, this guy, you know, never, you know, rarely swings at the first pitch, but sometimes he will, you know, or vice versa, you know. I think they're trying to make more educated decisions, you know, trying to get a little better. But I think you're right. You know, this idea that we can fully predict what's going to happen, you know, is incorrect. And, you know, you had asked me earlier about one of the misconceptions about, you know, analytics. And I said this belief that it's the whole ball game, you know, right, that it's everything. And it's not, you know, I mean, it is not, but it's a small component of how a pitcher gets a hitter out. And all those other elements, you know, are still there. Randomness, luck, how are they feeling? You know, what happened, you know, at home the night before, you know, how confident do they feel going up to the plate? Maybe something somebody said to them that either inspired confidence, didn't. I mean, all of that.
So we saw that in the World Series with Bryce Harper.
Yeah, you see that. But all of that is still true. And mm-hmm. it's still worth doing the homework, you know, just because, you know, knowing that this person is more likely to swing or not, or typically, you know, is better against curveballs than fastballs. It doesn't mean that, you know, if this guy is bad against fastballs and I throw him a fastball, you know, I win. You know, I mean, very often you'll see the guy will hit a home run. Maybe because you didn't execute, or maybe even if you did, but more educated guesses. And if you had to be 100% certain in baseball, you know, you wouldn't be able to do anything sort of thing.
Well, let's talk about some of the new things and talk about the future of baseball, but actually just looking at what's going to happen next year and just get your feedback on pretty much three different things that are going to be the changes. The pitch clock. What's your take on that?
Yeah, I think the pitch clock is going to be one of the most positive kind of innovations or interventions that we've seen in baseball in a long, long time. And I say that as somebody who is skeptical. When I first heard the discussion, I'm kind of a baseball purist, this idea, one of the things that differentiates baseball, there is no clock.
Right.
And, what better way to spend an afternoon than, at the ballpark, the idea like, well, we should spend less time there, I think was anachronistic to me. But but having seen it in action in the minor leagues, and not just me, I think kind of you can't find anyone that criticizes
so
it.
So you saw this in my, if I'm not mistaken, if the pitcher doesn't throw the ball in what, 15 seconds, I'm like, is it a ball called?
Mm-hmm. It is.
So,
and what happened?
So what would, I mean, the bases are loaded, okay? And all of a sudden, I'm a young pitcher, and for a moment, I just get caught up, and I'm nervous, and it's 18 or 20 seconds go by. I mean, is it going to be that quick, like somebody's mid 15 seconds, and okay, it's like a balk?
Yeah, I think you're right. There's a scenario where because you don't throw the ball quick enough, it costs the game, and this seems really problematic, right? But I guess what you'll see in practice and what you saw in the minor leagues, and I give Major League Baseball a lot of credit for experimenting, is pretty quickly the players adapted. There were some of these incidences in the first week or two, but by the middle or towards the end of the season, it really was extremely rare.
I guess what I'm looking at, this is where it gets into maybe just pulling out thing. So we've got the thing where the catcher and the pitcher are connected by the technology. Okay. That's a little sad. We've seen so many times they can't hear, something goes wrong. Is that subtracted from your, if I'm getting ready to pitch and I got to shake you up because I can't hear, I'm using up my 15 seconds.
I trust that they'll have that ironed out and the idea is not, some sort of pitch comm delay.
Right.
But let's go to the benefits, right? So I think you're right. There are some sort of costs or maybe this scenario, but what are the benefits? I mean, they're reducing the games by about a half hour. All of the time taken out is dead time. You're finding the time between, action, the ball being put in play is much quicker. And, diehard baseball fans have it in our blood.
Okay, Sam, because I know you have an interest in literature, okay,
yes.
I'm gonna move from sports to literature and show you what I think the problem is. You are a playwright, okay? And in the old days, what would happen? You would be a scene in Act One where the phone would ring across stage, okay? And you have to walk across the stage to answer the phone. That to me is drama, right? If, for example, the phone rings today and you put your hand in your pocket and you pull out your cell phone, that's not drama. I need to see you walking across the stage. Now, back to baseball. I grew up with the Yankees. Whitey Ford is having a great year. But Louis Arroyo, the little lifesaver, the guy would come in, walk in with the jacket over there, like the gunslinger, That to me, you're waiting. There was no walk-on music or things of that. So there was this thing, this guy would come in, not on a vehicle. He would walk in slow. And it was like the whole thing out of the Western.
Yeah, I think part of it is you're not the target audience anymore. It's hard to say it, but today,
Thanks, Sam.
Today, growing up, with a million images a second, right, and their phone is pinging nonstop, right, and the attention spans aren't what they were. And I'll just say this: as somebody who considers myself a baseball purist, mm-hmm, and was maybe concerned that we would be catering to the casual fan, having seen it in practice,
right,
really is beautiful. I just think, I'm expecting a mea culpa from you in a year. Having seen it quicker, the pacing, right, is better. People are happy to be at the game. I don't think that the soul of baseball has been really, really scarred here. And that's just my expectation, is that it's going to get very strong reviews. It has thus far. And, the people at Major League Baseball, Theo Epstein, Morgan Sorr, these are people I trust, deeply. They're talking about trying to make baseball the best version of itself, and I think the pitch clock is going to be an innovation in that direction, and you may just have to wait and see, because I agree, I had the same initial reaction adding a clock to baseball. This is the thinking man's game, this is not what we should be doing, but in practice I've been persuaded, and I think You will be too.
Well, people, you've been this way, and you've made a tremendous contribution to baseball, especially here in Washington. You were the assistant general manager for baseball research and development. Talk specifically about what your responsibilities were. It seems as if this was a job that you created, you know, and so talk about what was there before you got there, and then what was there after you left.
Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. No, it was a dream come true to work with the Nationals. And I mean, I started in, as an intern, and then my first full-time job was as an analyst. I was the, you know, first analyst in the Washington Nationals front office. Now it's, I think they have 10 or 11 analysts, and it's a title that you see, you know, every single major league club has several of. Built out that department so that it had a dozen analysts and several web developers, building internal tools and analysis to help with decision making throughout the organization, whether that was player acquisitions and trying to improve the sorts of decisions we made there, or some of the things we had talked about before about how do you prepare for the opponent.
Let me ask you a question in terms of, you built this department. What type of people would you look for if you were hiring? I mean, what's going into these job descriptions? If, for example, I was a person listening to you talking on this show, and I found this very interesting in terms of the going into this field, what would you encourage me to learn on the undergraduate level at college?
Yeah, I mean, I'd say a couple things. I would say that, you know, the skill set you're looking for is a data science skill set, you know, which are a lot of the same skills you're seeing in other fields people are hiring in politics, at Netflix, at Amazon, somebody who can do predictive data analysis, you know, majoring in computer science or statistics. The other thing I would say is, look, you don't have to have the job to do the job. You want to be a baseball analyst, you know, finding new discoveries and creating data visualizations and speaking about the game. You can go do it, you know, right now. There's a lot of public data. You know, I say if you want to be a surgeon, you know, you shouldn't start cutting people up. You know, that'd be bad. If you want to be a baseball, you know, analyst, you can start doing it and you can publish it. And there's a robust online, you know, forum and community, and baseball executives are reading and hiring people who are public researchers. And
let me show you what my concern is, and I'll show you the comparison of my field. I saw, for example, within the field of, say, library science, okay, especially if you go to the conferences, I saw it was a period in which a new group of people came in, younger, very much into the technology and, you know, data. And you say, well, what was the last novel you read? You know, I'm just, you know, well, I saw some green ones over there, you know. And what happened? I would be concerned about hiring people with these technical skills, but not having a love for the game.
Yeah. Yeah. I think you're right that that is a concern. I guess what I would say is, some of that love for the game, subject matter expertise, knowledge, passion is what separates the people that move up. And, you know, the game and the decisions have gotten so complex, the data set's so large, that there is a role for, you know, kind of a data analyst who maybe doesn't have a deep understanding or passion for the game or doesn't have those communication skills. What you'll find is that they're going to be limited. You know, they'll end up.
Let's look at you. I mean, when we pull the articles about you, you know, you seem to have like a sort of Hollywood film type of life. You know, the bat boy comes up and now all of a sudden you're assistant general manager. I mean, it seems that that's the type of story that, if I'm a baseball fan, I love that story. Okay. And to me, there's a trust when I listen to you talk about baseball. You approach it, you know, with the data, with the analyst, but you have the love for the game. You have a love for the players and the managers. And I wonder whether you see that being something that unique to you, or, for example, you see a lot of young people coming in with that same excitement.
I don't think it's unique to me. I see it in a lot of people. I think, you know, it may look a little different at times. And so sometimes people may not recognize it if a lot of your baseball passion manifests in building models or blogging or spending less time at the ballpark than I have. But to me, you know, these analysts, most of them are, you know, what I call affectionately a baseball rat, you know, somebody who's super passionate about the game, and grows up in it. And I just think it looks a little bit different than it had in the past. And sometimes from an organizational dynamic perspective, one of the things you need to do is build that trust and realize that everybody, you know, they may talk differently. They may have different backgrounds. Some of these people may have less time spent in the game, but oftentimes, kind of a common thread is a real passion for baseball. So no, I don't think that's unique to me.
Well, you know, when I grew up, you know, my love for baseball was come also getting like, you know, the sporting news and things of that sort. Are there any books that you would recommend, you know, for our viewers in terms of, you know, getting a better understanding how baseball is changing?
Totally. Yeah. I mean, a formative book for me, it's maybe 15 or 20 years old at this point, is a book called The Book, Playing the Percentages in Baseball. It's got three authors, one of whom now works for Major League Baseball, Tom Tango. That was a book I used to carry around with me all the time. Mm-hmm. There's a book that published a few years ago called The MVP Machine, which I think does a great job of detailing how data has been used by players to change the way that they train and are coached.
You know, you recommended that book to me, and that totally changed my understanding of analytics. You know, it just got into a thing in terms of, you know, saving careers, for example.
Totally, yeah. And I mean, two more I'll say that are maybe a little less numbers based, but and more on the baseball. I mean, one is a book I read recently, How to Beat a Broken Game, by Pedro Moro, about the Dodgers, who are one of the thought leaders in this area. And so just by kind of detailing their baseball operation, you get a great introduction. And one last one is a book, K, A History of Baseball in 10 Pitches, which is by Tyler Kepner, and a little less analytical, but very modern. And so, of course, it touches up on all these topics. And you know, that's a book that just kind of oozes the love for baseball.
I got to ask you this last question. Okay. You don't have to answer it, but, you know, what do you feel is the future of the Washington Nationals?
Look, I mean, I think I go back, and it was quite an accomplishment to win the World Series in 2019. You know, a dream come true. That's not easy. And, you know, I hope and expect that they'll get back there, but it's a long road, and you can never take those for granted. So
okay, long road and a short show. Okay,
yeah, long road and short show. And I guess I'll talk to you know.
Right, I always enjoy talking with you. You know, I've learned a lot, and I'm deeply grateful that you could take time out and be my guest on the Scholars.
Likewise, it's a pleasure of mine.